a long time ago, that, because that was two projects ago.
Yeah.
Yeah, when I was working on the church project.
Yes.
And in the interim between that and Detroit work, I did a project at rural Illinois.
That, yes, I remember that. You were working on that when you came here last.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So, well, let me give you a little background on me. I'm born and raised in Detroit, and I went to the Center for Creative Studies, now called the College for Creative Studies, which is in Detroit. It's a private art school, and I studied photography there back in the 70s. And I did a lot of documentary work as a student at the time. It's all black and white street photography, large format, 35 millimeter. I did a bunch of projects. But then I graduated in 1974, and then I got married, and I had to get a job, and I had to find a way to make a living. And I worked at a museum for a couple of years, but really got stuck in the dark room, and I felt really underappreciated, underutilized. I felt my potential was much greater than where they had placed me. So I quit the museum after 2 years and then freelanced in Detroit for a year, but I didn't want to photograph cars. And in order to make money in Detroit, that's all you had to do. You couldn't do anything else. So I packed my bags and I moved to Chicago in 1977, and that's when I started a career as a commercial photographer. And I never assisted anybody. This kind of surprises a lot of people, but I just felt I was a photographer. You know, for me, it was just, I'll make a little portfolio, and I shot samples in my living room when I was still living in Detroit. I had about 15 or 20 samples under my arm, and I just moved to Chicago and said, this is either going to make it or break it. So I had that kind of determination, you know, and faith in myself that I think I can do this, you know. And my wife and I, we were in the little loft down in South Wall Street in Old Town, and we had our first little studio there. And I was there for like 22 years, you know, with the UN space. And throughout those years, I developed a career as a commercial photographer, and I specialized in food and product photography. And I built my career around that kind of specialty, because Chicago was just, that's what I wanted to do. I was very passionate about that type of work, and it kept my interest up until just a couple of years ago when I retired. So I also bought a building down in South Prairie Avenue, and for the last 15, 16 years, I had a studio building down there that I ran my business out of. But I always had a rep, you know. I never wanted to like go out and sell myself. I always felt it was critical that I would stay in the studio and work and create work for my portfolio and have someone else go out and try to sell me. So that's not always every photographer's point of view, because if you hire a rep, you got to give them, you know, about 30%, 35% of what you make. So, but for me, it was always a very even trade-off, because being a rep is a very difficult job, and I didn't want to handle any of that. So, getting back to where I started as a student, as a documentary photographer, around 2000, I became interested in scanning my work, all my old work, and I presented it to a photography dealer in Chicago, and she looked at the work, and she just kind of said, what are you doing here? This is all old stuff, you know, it's nice, but have you kept a pace of what's going on in the fine art market and how photographers are approaching their projects? And so, and I said, no. I said, I've just been working in a commercial studio for the last 20 years. So she said, well, why don't you try and figure out what it is you want to do and rediscover photography for yourself. So I went out and I produced a project on Chicago bridges that lasted like a year. And it was the most successful fine art project I've ever done. I've sold over 250 prints from this one body of work alone. And every condominium association or health club, a lot of private law firms and just bought this stuff like crazy because it was, you know, they were really beautiful photographs. And they were sort of more emotionally charged too because I shot them all in really bad weather. You know, it was raining and snow and dark. And I thought it was more of a powerful sort of connection to the work when I photographed it that way because these structures were so large and looming and industrial looking and powerful. I didn't want them to look like postcards, so it was a really beautiful series. And that was sort of like me taking myself out of the studio, right? Where I had this very controlled environment and lighting and composition. I shot everything 8x10 Ektachrome for 25 years. So I sort of took those principles out into the real world and sort of made these compositions of bridges that to me were like still lifes. You know, I kind of treated them very formalistically and carefully, and I shot them all with a view camera and everything. So that was sort of like my first attempt to kind of figure out what it is I wanted to do. And it was fine, but I discovered this little neighborhood over in East Chicago, Indiana, called Marktown. And it was this historic little pocketed community of mostly Hispanics and poor black people that were living in the center of all the industrial factories that were surrounding it. So I concentrated for about a year, year and a half, working in Marktown and documenting the people there. But I did it all in color because it was such a colorful little community. And that was the beginning of my focus on looking at cultural identity and people and how they're placed within society and where they live and how they relate to their environment. And it became clear to me that I was going back to my roots as a Detroit photographer. I'm doing the same thing I did 25 or 30 years ago. It was like stepping outside the door and just picking up where I left off. And that was a wonderful sort of experience for me. And that led to the church project, because every time I drove over to Marktown, I'd see this little church that had a sign above it, the door. It said Cathedral of Divine Love. I thought, that's a beautiful little name for a church. I wonder what that looks like. And I'd seen so many photographs of the outsides of these small churches, but I've never seen anybody really go inside document the interiors of these churches, you know, where the pastor has set them up and decorated them and made the parishioners that come in feel comfortable and want to be in that environment. It wasn't always so much about what the pastor had to say, but it was really more about feeling comfortable in the space and how the pastor set it up. So for 3.5 years, I documented the inside of about 100 churches on the south side of Chicago, these little tiny storefront joints, you know, that have like 8 or 10 members every Sunday, and that's it. You probably know about them, right?
I'm asking you.
Yeah, I'm pretty, yeah. So it was a wonderful project for me. I got to meet all these pastors and all these wonderful people. I had a book published, it was called Articles of Faith, came out in 2009. That was the show that I had at the Cultural Center. So here I am again, you know, I'm kind of like looking at culture, I'm looking at identity, I'm looking at a sense of place, and it's all very much an urban environment. And then I did the Rural Illinois project where I wanted to get out of the city and I wanted to discover Illinois. I wanted to see what the farmland was like, you know, but who were the people that lived there and how their idiosyncratic kind of qualities sort of marked the land and stuff. So I did another like 3-year project on rural. So these are all things that I kind of pick projects one at a time, but I don't work on anything else but one project at a time until it's completed. So around 2000, and we could be, passes around, it's kind of like flip through, you can look through that book and kind of get a sense of what it was I tried to achieve. But what happened in 2009 was that all these photographers were going to Detroit. Andrew Moore, and he did a book called Detroit Disassembled, and then the two Frenchmen, Marchand and Murphy, did a book called Ruins of Detroit. And these books hit me so hard because all they showed were abandonment, emptiness, walls with flaking paint, and no people at all in these books about Detroit. And I thought, man, this is kind of lopsided. I come from Detroit. I know what it looks like. I experienced it growing up there. And I just felt that those books were, they're part of Detroit's history, and it's probably valid that they went there to document what they found. But it was very one-sided, one-dimensional kind of story. And I thought, there's still 700,000 people who live in Detroit. Where are they in these photographs that these photographers went to document? And then I thought, I need to go back and maybe explore the city in a different way and sort of like counter, sort of flip the script, so to speak, on what it was that these photographers saw and what it is that needs to be seen. And that's for the last 5 years I worked on this project in Detroit, where I just went through neighborhoods and met people. And I didn't know anybody from the beginning, okay? I just went, you know, I mean, I had to start from square one when I went back, because I had been gone for 30 years, right? So, coming from a background of product photography, I never photographed people or anything, but I felt a real necessity to meet people and photograph them, because that was the story that was missing about Detroit. And this was long before the city actually filed for bankruptcy, okay, like a couple, 2 or 3 years before. So I made like 33, 34 trips to Detroit, and I'd stay about 2 weeks at a time. So if you add that all up, that's about a year that I actually spent in Detroit in the last 5 years. And I've made hundreds of friends, and I keep going back now and seeing the same people that I photographed over and over and over again, because I felt I needed to keep this connection kind of going. But anyway, the book came out just this last September, and Amazon, the editors of Amazon, placed it as one of the best photo books of 2015, so I'm really quite proud that I got that recognition. And it's selling really well, so. But anyway, I've got a set of prints that I'd like to show the students,
yes,
so they get a sense of the quality of the work for exhibition purposes, too. But I just want to say something about my projects, all sort of like, whenever I start a project, I'm always thinking in the end, is this going to be a book? You know, what is the time commitment? What is the dedication? What is the passion? What is going to sustain me to live and work through a project that could last 5 years? That's not an easy thing for anyone to do. And that's the heart of why I'm a photographer, is because of the passion and the love of the subject matter that I want to document. And I've always seen myself as a social documentarian. I've never been like a landscape. I mean, I've done landscape work, but the heart of what I like to do is people oriented and social, urbanism and stuff like that. So, but just like as students, you know, I mean, how do you, you guys are probably all working on your own projects, right? Doing your own thing throughout the semester. Building a body of work, you're not just taking one picture, you're taking photographs that relate to each other throughout a series and stuff. So it's only going to get better if you really are into what you're doing, you know, if you really enjoy it. And that's kind of the biggest, it's not a hurdle, but it's the biggest component of taking good photographs, is being engaged and passionate about what you're doing. The rewards will come back tenfold, and if you feel like, oh, I got to do this assignment, you know, blah, 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 boring, or whatever, I got to get 6 prints by next week, don't look at it that way. You really have to pick a subject that you really, really are interested in. But anyway, I'm gonna grab these prints.
There's something in that cooler.
Yeah, I was gonna do a slide presentation on that stuff.
Well, this is so much better. We have that. That's kind of the coin of the realm here is slide presentations to see prints.
But anyway, it's nice to show this work because then I can talk about the individuals. You know. This is a photograph of Glennie, and he's a raccoon hunter as well as a blues player. And I actually looked him up. I found him on the internet doing research. And the article was about his raccoon hunting skills. He gets a license every fall, and he goes out into the country of Michigan and bags about 30 or 40 raccoons, and he brings them home, and then he skins them, dresses them, and he sells them as food to friends of his throughout the wintertime. And he grew up in like Alabama, or a sharecropping farm, and was picking cotton as a kid and stuff. And raccoon was a very daily sort of like menu for he and his family when he was born. So he asked me if I wanted to taste some. I kind of passed, but he had a couple of in the freezer. They didn't even look like raccoons. And so at that moment, I thought, man, I can't photograph them with a raccoon because no one's going to believe this one. So I saw all these guitars and stuff lying around his house. And he said, you play any guitar? And he goes, oh, I play blues, man. So he played for like a couple hours for me. And it's one of the few shots. I usually shoot veiled light, but this was actually lit with an electronic flash strobe. I kind of set it all up.
So when you're photographing with electronic flash, what is the what are you going for? You're going for, as we, I would say, here there is kind of this blending, this sort of very subtle hint that there might be light added to the scene.
Yeah, I mean, there's an exposure from the window, right? And that's sort of like calculated, setting up the shot, making sure I'm blowing out the detail there. And then the rest of it is filled in with the flash. You just dial the power up on the flash and up and down until you get the proper exposure. But, it was just really dark in his house, so it's kind of like, well, he has electricity, because a lot of his black photographs don't have electricity. But anyway, he was, and it was still like a half a quarter of a second exposure with the flash, because this required a certain amount of exposure to get the ambient light kind of coming out.
Can you talk a little bit about, we got the book here, I know I came across the image of the book. Mm-hmm. That experience, you mentioned the book is kind of something you envision at the end of the project. We got the large print piece, we got the reproduction of the book. What kind of questions or critical thoughts go through your mind as you go through that process? Is this, the real piece? Is this the most important piece? Or is it the idea of seeing sequentially all these images together?
They're both important for various reasons, but these are for exhibition purposes, on a wall in a museum or a gallery. And it's a very selective sort of breakdown from the total body of the work. This has 90 photographs in it, but in an exhibition you can put maybe 20. I have a show up the Filter Space right now. You guys know Filter Space over there on West Hubbard?
Yeah, we went as a group.
1821 West Hubbard, little gallery there. Yeah, yeah. Just opened up the gallery. So I have a show going on right now. It's at Filter Space. But there's only like 16 pieces in the show.
Yeah.
But it's a very strong body of work. So you try to like collect your best work for exhibition purposes. But, the thing about an exhibition, it's very ephemeral. It's temporary. It's gone. three or four weeks, poof, it's, you know, never going to appear again. The book, it's permanent. You know, it's last years. It goes in institutions, goes in collections. It's a lasting document of a time and place that's kind of critical for today.
Do you work with a book designer?
I did, yeah. Sam Silvio designed the book. Sam is a Chicago graphic designer.
Was he instrumental then in the choice of sequencing?
Or? Sam actually paired a lot of the photographs together in the book, which was kind of interesting. I sort of had an edit on that.
Pairing here, I mean, it's really the fidelity to color.
It's
really
pretty good. I'm about.
I've seen Eggleston works that are like so far off.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I proofed this book myself.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Yeah, it was a chore. It was like I went through like seven rounds of proofs. Mm-hmm. And I kept, you know, honing them down every time I did another edition that came less and less and less. But the first proofs were just like, oh my God, I got the wrong printer here.
Yeah.
It was so bad.
Did you print them in China? Or did you print them?
They were printed in China, but I didn't go to China. I didn't go on the press run or anything. I just wrote the proofs in my studio, and I worked with a proofing company in Canada. So they would send me a proof, and then I would have the file on my computer. And if I saw something I wanted to change, I would change it. As opposed to marking up the proof and saying too red, too dark, lightened, I didn't let them do that. I told them from the start, I'm going to make the corrections on these files, and then I'm going to send them to you. And then you're going to make me another proof. And they said, well, do we really have to do that? I said, yeah. I know what I'm looking at.
Is that unusual for photographers?
It was unusual, yeah. Typically, they just mark them up, and then they make another proof, and then they send it back. But I'm all calibrated, you know? I mean, I wanted this reproduction to look like my prints. And I have a sort of a special look to the way how my prints look, so.
How would you characterize that?
Softer, yeah, a little less contrast, mm-hmm. a little slightly muted, mm-hmm. sort of warm. Mm-hmm. And the first set of proofs I got were just like right out of kaleidoscope nightmare. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were just like day glow, neon, the strongest color. God, these are awful. So I really struggled trying to get them to like understand how I like to look at my photographs.
I don't mean to get too technical with it, but did you agree to that all part of the contract and publishing deal? Like I'm going to maintain control.
Yeah, you know, with Powerhouse.
Yeah.
They were pretty good about it. They knew I was very, very critical and sensitive about how the work was going to work. So they. You know, they were getting frustrated with me towards the end. Like, come on, Dave, you gotta get these to the printer. And you're wasting, you know, precious time here. So,
did you make the prints then, or
I make these prints? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have a printer at home, so I use an Epson 988 printer, and then I have a rib, you know, like a color by rib that I use with the custom profiles and stuff. So what I see at my monitor is really almost dead nuts to the print. So it's pretty critical. If you know what your monitor is giving you, then you have a much better idea of how your print's going to come out. That's a photograph of a child in a cat's house. And Cat was a woman that would take anyone in her house, you know, any homeless mother or any drug addict, any alcoholic that needed a place to sleep for the night or a meal to eat or clothing to be given. Cat would let them come into her house. And she had this tiny little like two-bedroom house, and sometimes there were 10 people living in her house. And oftentimes she would go stay at an abandoned house down the alley so that someone else could have her room. She was a very giving kind of person.
How are you finding your subjects?
Driving around. I mean, that was my modus operandi. I just drove around the city and just I saw something interesting, I would get out of my car. And she had a yard next to her house that was all sort of landscaped with lights and a little rock garden and stuff. And I thought, this is really a pretty little yard that someone has really taken the time and the care to cultivate and make the neighborhood look pretty. I wonder who did that, you know? So I got out of my car and I just go to the yard and I take a picture of the yard. And then, of course, you know, she's watching me out the window. You know, and then the conversation starts and we get to talking and, you know, 2 hours later I'm still talking to her and, you know, we're having a great conversation and I just go, gee, I really love to photograph you too, you know, in your car, you know, let me take a picture of you. She said, of course, and we did, and then I went back the following month and I took a print and I gave it to her and I said, here's a photograph I took of you in the garden. And you know, and then she invited me in, and she goes, you want something to eat? And I said, sure. And before you know it, she's introducing me to everybody in the house, and that's where this photograph, and, you know, came about. This is in one of the private bedrooms of her house.
It would seem
that she gave me total reign of the house. You know, she just goes, I trust you.
But your skills as a communicator, as a... your people skills, it seemed to be very keenly developed. That
it's part
they have this kind of an entrees.
Well, you know, when you have an idea in your head of what you're trying to achieve and accomplish, you have to be able to work that through.
Yeah.
And it's not always the photograph that gets you to mm-hmm. that point. What happens before all that.
Yep.
And it's trust and it's confidence and it's honesty and it's just this connection of making a connection with people that kind of like put you in their trust. You know, they know that what you're doing is not going to be degrading or denigrating in any way or, you know, negative. Because everyone in Detroit, it's like, well, do you come here and take bad pictures of Detroit? You know, I mean, you're going to make us look bad. And I said, no, I'm not like other photographers who don't want to be involved in the community.
Yeah.
I want to be here.
Yeah. Well, you would need faith in your own vision. Faith in your
what
you were trying to say.
You know, it's
the worth
no
of
doubt,
the
yeah.
worthiness of your own statement.
Yeah, and I think that all goes back to the fact that I'm from there. And I think there's a connection. At least for me, I felt there was a connection to why I was taking these photographs.
I'm sort of intrigued with this dual career, you know, the commercial part, and you said, you know, food and product, so no people.
No, I hated shooting people.
So how did that skill of developing a relationship with the subject develop in the context of the commercial work? Was it like a...
Well, you know, I mean, even though I shot food and product, I had to deal with art directors, I had to deal with account executives, I had to deal with clients.
Yeah.
So you're still dealing with people.
Yeah.
So you use the skills that you learned as a commercial photographer in being diplomatic and, you know, accommodating. And I kind of just took that and then applied it to, like, meeting strangers, you know, I guess. I never really quite analyze it. It was kind of, like I said, I had a need, and I wanted to photograph people, and I had to like teach myself how to do it, and force myself in a way outside my own comfort zone to be able to get the access that I wanted. And I always wanted to do it in a very kind of respectful, humanistic kind of way. This is a photograph.
Is it as it seems that you encountered this fellow as he was unloading his van and
I was photographing a couple of kids across the street.
Encounter.
Yeah, at the time that this, before I took his photograph.
Mm-hmm.
But he was watching me.
Again, just on, I didn't want to belabor the technical parts of it, but camera on and. The Hasselblad that you were using when you came here, and camera mounted on a tripod then? Or?
Yeah, I was always on a tripod.
Yeah.
I treated all the work that I did as if I was working with a view camera, because that's what I was used to doing my whole career.
Yeah.
So I'm very sort of plotted and deliberate with how I set up the photograph, and I compose it slow, and the subject's standing there, feeling impatient and stuff. But I'm trying to slow the whole process down.
Yeah.
And I'm having a conversation at the same time.
Yeah.
And that's just the way I've always worked.
Yeah.
Even when I was a student back in the 70s, I had a view camera. And, street portraits and stuff like that.
Yeah.
This is a photograph of Marshall and Jeanette. And they're actually squatting in a house on a street called Golden Gate in Detroit. And I spent many days on Golden Gate Street documenting the people that live there. And there's a kind of a community kind of thing going on where they all sort of help each other out, and they grow their own crops, and they chop their own wood, and they repurpose their abandoned houses with wood-burning stoves in the wintertime and stuff. So it's sort of like a hippie commune sort of group. And it's had its ups and downs. It's had some crime and some drugs and some alcohol and stuff, but it's sort of filtered itself out now, whereas the last few years, the people that are still there are the ones that are really working as kind of a group. And it's sort of really mellowed out quite a bit.
When you go into an environment like this, what are you looking for in terms of that place to photograph these individuals? And do you alter it, what you find? For example, was there things on the floor, or did it seem like that was the only place you could make this photograph?
I really love the blue of the walls and stuff, and they had painted the wall and put the little statue up. Marshall was, a lot of faith-based ideas about life and all that stuff. And Jeanette was just kind of there as his companion. But I picked the room. I mean, I think they slept in another room. But I just love the coloration. I love the mirror and the wall.
It's just window light then for this?
Yeah,
as well?
Yeah, it's just a room with window light.
The colors are comfortable.
Yeah.
Even the colors are supposed to be purple.
Yeah. Just right over here.
Yeah. And what do you say to your subject matter to get like that emotion from it?
I don't know. We were
just having a. I see it in all the shots. Like when you're about to take the photograph, like, do you recall like the words exchanged? Because like usually. From my experience,
I'm just kind of going, that looks great, don't move. I mean, your expressions are beautiful right now. I really like what I see. I'm kind of like acting like a fashion photographer or something. I'm just, I'm working it a little bit. I'm trying to get them to feel like good about themselves, because they don't know what I'm seeing, right? It's always important that all my subjects sort of look at the camera, because I think it's really important to get that connection in the eyes. It's really important. To me than anything else. But yeah, I mean, I took several photographs. I mean, it's digital, right? I mean, it's not like I'm exchanging film holders, I'm like taking a shot every minute. I'm taking, five or six shots a minute, So I've got a lot to edit with when I get back home. I can look and see what I did.
Do you send these back to them? People in the photographs that they.
Oh, yeah, everyone gets a print, This is a portrait of Diane sleeping.
Beautiful.
And this is another photograph that I lit artificially because the room was completely black. And at the time I took this picture, I was actually photographing someone else. I was photographing Michael, who had his legs cut off and he was in a wheelchair. I had met him several times on the street. Wanted to photograph him in his house, so he invited me over one time. So I photographed Mike, and then I look over my shoulder, and this woman is sleeping on the couch. And I said,
"Who's that?"
And Mike goes, "Oh, she's homeless. She's just staying here for a few days." He didn't you didn't really know anything about her. And I said, well, I think I have a golden opportunity here. So I kind of swung the light around and the camera around and just took
She slept through the whole thing.
Quick photograph. She never knew I had a picture. And then I went back a month later to give her a print, and they said, she's gone. Yeah. We don't know where she went. She only was only there for a day or two, and then we took off. So this one right now is at the it's going to be in the exhibition at the National Portrait Gallery.
Yeah, that's really
at
special.
The Outland Bochever competition I entered. Yeah. And you can only enter one photograph.
Yeah.
So it got in. So they had like 2,500 entries, and it took 43 artists. Yeah, and it's not just photography. It's all painting, drawing, sculpture, photography. So out of the 43 selected artists, maybe just a handful of photographers. So
yeah. Can you tell us how you chose that for that competition? Chose this piece for that competition?
I just thought it was different enough that, you know, it was a competition for portrait, but she's unaware that I even took her photograph. So is it really a portrait, or is it, you know? So I was kind of stretching the definition of what a portrait is, and I think they liked that, and I wanted to. You know, and it's such a lush photograph anyway. Mm-hmm. It's luminous kind of quality.
Did you write about that part of it when you submitted the piece to the competition?
No, because I couldn't describe anything. Yeah. Just kind of submitted the photograph. So I made the initial cut of like 110, and then they wanted you to like send the framed piece finished down to Washington for the final selection. So it's like, oh wow. Spent several $100, but they picked up the piece and had an art handler pick it up and then ship it down there. And then I got the notice a couple of months ago that, oh, you're going to be in the show next year. So
kind of cool.
So the opening's in March. We'll be going down to the opening. So see that. So part of a lot of what the project about Detroit was about was daily life, kind of like pulling back and seeing a larger environment when people and how they use the city. These are Detroit police cadets that are just graduating from the academy, and they were actually training in an abandoned strip mall parking lot. And I asked the sergeant about that, and he said, oh, we like to be visibly present in the community because it's a good public relations sort of like activity for us, you know, and they see that we're here and we're present, and it makes people feel safer and stuff, instead of like training behind, you know, closed walls and all that stuff. So you see them marching down the street all the time. And stuff. And so
I don't feel safer. I don't know. You know, it's like the opposite.
So you were somewhat elevated.
I was standing up on my car.
On the roof.
On the roof of my car.
Yeah.
Yeah, the dealer, when I traded in, had a lot of questions.
What are you doing to your car? Yeah. This Ansel Adams had a truck that was built.
Yeah, he had a platform and everything with a ladder and a lot.
Oh, man.
So this is Mo. And he was, he raised pigeons for like 20 years at this location.
Wow.
And just kind of like crazy character. I saw the house, and I saw all these kind of like propped up platforms all over it. I didn't know what it was all about. Went into the front gate and just sort of like inquired. He was so excited to like show me all his birds. It's this and that, and I got this one and that one.
You had him stand at that, I mean, that light that he's standing is so...
Yeah, I don't know why he went over there. I don't know. I didn't really place him. He was just working or something, and the birds were kind of flying in and stuff. And I think when the birds see him, they all kind of come because he knows that they're going to get fed.
Yeah.
He's since passed away, but a lot of people, the last 5 years I've been working there, these are just a Bangladeshi neighborhood on the north side of town where kids are playing cricket. in an abandoned parking lot. There aren't a lot of parks and stuff that kids can go to or play in Detroit, so they gotta just figure it out, you know, the hard way here by running into like concrete stones and things. Kind of dangerous to play in a place like this, but it's still, it's a place where the community kind of gathers and comes together and still tries to make the best of situations. This is a photograph of Hakeem in a room that he had for 5 years. He drew little quotes on the wall and then would, you know, circle them and move on and do the next one. A lot of them are original quotes that he's thought up, and a lot of them are like facts and tidbits and little things about culture and religion and stuff.
But, and again, available light?
Yeah, that's just like a 6-second exposure. He held pretty well.
Yeah.
You know, there's a little bit of movement in his breathing, but that's okay. But he lived in this room. He bought a house for like $500. It's like, you know, bought it at the tax auction in Detroit. You know, he was the only one that lived in it. Didn't have any electricity, no hot water, no heat. He had a grill, like a gas grill, that he would cook on, and also the grill would actually heat the room. But after like 2 years, all these walls turned black from soot, from the gas and everything. So this is all gone.
Okay.
He and I stay in touch quite a bit. We text each other all the time. We're totally good friends. And this I'm up for this prize in Canada. It's called the AMI-AGO Prize. And I was shortlisted with 3 other artists. And right now I'm in a big show at the AGO in Toronto. And they have a popular vote. And whoever wins the popular vote gets $50,000. So
good luck.
I'm hoping, because I've earmarked all the money to go back to people in Detroit. Hakeem was going to be one of the people I was going to give money to and try to help him buy a house. Because the one he's living in, the basement's full of like 3 feet of water. Mm-hmm. And every time it rains, the roof looks like crazy. And I think at some point the floors that he lives on the second floor is going to collapse.
Yes.
So, and he knows that. I've told him, I said, Hakeem, if I win this, prize, you're going to get a house. We're going to find something for you. Because you can buy a house in Detroit for like $10,000, fairly decent house. So, there's a few people in Detroit that I want to help out that way. Yeah, but I got to win the award. So, and I'm the only photographer in the whole show that has really traditional kind of documentary based work. All the other artists or conceptual artists or, you know, sculpture and video and studio kind of work. And then you come into the room where my work is at. It's kind of like, wow, something I can understand.
Lots of pretty good then.
Well, I think are probably in my favor because the work is easy to digest and connect to. All the other work is kind of, it's not that it's not good work, it's good work, but it's, you know, far more intellectually, conceptually based, kind of like just trying to understand the meaning behind a lot of the work. You really got to read a lot of text and stuff. But my stuff is just much more, you know, basic kind of traditional documentary photography. I go next week. Actually, I think December 1st is the announcement. So we'll see. If anything, I get $5,000 as being a runner-up if I don't win. And then I get a 6-week residency in Canada. Anywhere I want to go to Canada and do work. So I'm thinking of going to Thunder Bay area, northern or Superior, Lake Superior area, doing some documentary work. This is just Sean's living room with his tufted chair, plastic covered chair that he likes to keep clean. No, I wish this is old.
I think he got out of a hotel or something.
But yeah, he can't. He's been living in this house for like 4 years, and it's, you know, he's just squatting in it. It's just an abandoned house. But he's neat as a pin. It's, you know, he likes to keep the floor clean and the tables clean. He does the best he can with what he's got. Some of these aren't in the book, but that's okay. This is a photograph of a couple of guys doing a YouTube video, doing a music video for themselves so they can put on YouTube. So they had their car off to the side of the frame with the doors open and the music blasting, and they were like, you know, lip syncing to their music. But they're doing this all in front of the Packard plant, which is largest automotive, well, actually the largest industrial abandoned site probably in the world. It's like 3.5 million square feet of abandoned, you know, industrial property. It sits on the east side of Detroit. And I looked at my birth certificate, and it said father's occupation, sheet metal work, Packard Automotive Plant. So my dad worked here. Back in the 40s, late 40s. So there was a really nice connection for me to be photographing these guys, you know, in front of this plant in my games. These are some firemen that were resting after putting an arson fire out on the east side of town. And it's one of the biggest problems in Detroit is arson fires. I mean, they probably put out 300 arson fires a month. There's just so much abandonment and empty homes in Detroit. And it's really easy to buy a gallon of gas and go have some fun and torch a house. You know, I mean, it's kind of like entertainment for these kids, you know. But it's a serious problem, and Detroit's trying to deal with it. I mean, there's like 30,000 abandoned homes and 80,000 abandoned lots in Detroit. That's almost 40% of the landmass of the city is empty. And have you guys, anybody been to Detroit? You guys have to go there just to experience it for yourselves. It's nothing, I've never seen anything like it. I still can't get used to the environment, you know, the visual environment when I go there.
Yeah.
I don't know. I just have a quick question. Like, have you ever had an encounter where things kind of got uneasy? Because I know, like, there's certain areas in Detroit, I mean, like, east side, for example, where they can get pretty
I spent most of my time on the east side. And the answer is no. I mean, all the trips that I've taken there, I've never had a negative encounter with anyone that I've met. It's sort of like, it's not that it couldn't happen.
Right.
I mean, there were times when I saw six teenage guys walking down the street coming towards me, and I'm just kind of thinking, well, maybe I should get in my car. Just sort of not sure how that reaction's going to go if they see me. So, and that was just an instinct of mine. So I would like preempt any time that I thought there might be a negative encounter, but that's not to say that it would have happened. I just kind of felt, teenage kids are just kind of like sometimes bravado and all that stuff, you know, machismo, and kind of go the wrong way. So. But that only happened like once in all the hundreds of encounters I had with people. So no, I have never had. Just a detailing shop on the east side on Conan Street. This is a donk car, you know, the big wheels.
Donk?
That's what they call these donks.
Donks.
Yeah. The other ones are the tiny little wheeled cars, the low riders. You know, they jump up and down and hop. They have all the hydraulics and stuff. This is sort of like the antithesis of that. These don't have all the hydraulics packed in the trunk. They just have big wheels. This guy had to modify the frame on this car. It cost them $7,200 to modify the frame to put these big wheels in. So here, he bought a car for probably $2,500 and then spent probably $1,000 per wheel plus the $7,200. So he's got, $15,000 into a car that's worth $2,500. That's cool.
One room alone is like $1,200.
One room alone? Oh, yeah.
Those things are really expensive. I mean, if you're really into cars,
and those are probably 26-inch wheels.
Mm-hmm.
Huge. It's barely. And then they got to get the low rider, low profile tires that are only about that,
Did you position the car for the photograph?
I did. I set that up. I actually drove by and I saw the car in the garage.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got out of my car, went in and introduced myself. I said, I want to photograph this car in front of your shop. I love the graphics, and I love the color of the car. And I said, this would be great if you guys would help me out and just put the car up front. And they said, hey, sure, man, cool. And they were cool, but I'm stopping traffic. I'm standing in the middle of the street. Got to be rather big production. And then I went back to give them a print, and the shop was gone. So there's so many of these places that are just sort of like temporary. They're kind of in there for a couple of months, and then they realize, the rent is due, and landlord's chopping down our neck, and we haven't made any money this week. So a lot of this kind of like dreams kind of like evaporate in a lot of these guys, because there's no work in Detroit. Just the unemployment level there is sky high, especially between black males between the ages of 18. A lot of them are in high school dropouts, no job opportunities. So they set up these little shops thinking that, it's going to go great. And then, hey, if we don't pay the rent for 3 months, so what, we'll give it a shot. So there's a lot of that in these little shops. Now this is a portrait of Tom. Also another one of my favorite people that I go back every time I go back to Detroit, I stop and photograph Tom. But this is a house in the background that he built for himself.
Mm.
And it's kind of an 8x10 foot cabin. And he builds it from discarded materials he finds in dumpsters and stuff. He doesn't have a job or doesn't make any money. So he takes his time collecting materials, and then when he's got enough, he'll build something. So he's been on this little patch of industrial property for the last 12 years. And this is the third house he's built. Now he's building a fourth structure that's going to be 16 by 16 feet and about two stories tall. And he keeps making bigger and bigger and bigger. And everything he's got, he's found.
He looks so noble in the photograph.
Oh yeah, he's wonderful. He's wonderful. He's kind of I wouldn't say he's an autistic savant, but he's a very skilled carpenter. He's very meticulous, and he works with a hammer and a tape measure and a rip saw. That's all he's got, and a screwdriver. That's how he does everything. There's no electric tools, nothing. So everything he does by hand, and it just takes him forever to cut a board, puts it in place, and it doesn't quite fit, so he trims it, puts it back. So, that's all he does. He just works on building these structures. But they're very sort of playful, and decorates them really beautifully and paints them and puts, just does a very original sort of artistic, almost like an outside artist, the way he treats his pieces. So anyway, I photographed him many, many times. These are just a couple of related cousins just out on the stoop one day. Private moment, braiding your hair and stuff. But these are the kinds of things that I wanted to document in Detroit that most photographers were sort of like eliminating, not paying attention to. I thought, man, there's all this activity and this movement and family and stuff that's so evident there. Why isn't anyone documenting that? So, and there's lots of photographers in Detroit too that live there. and they still don't quite get, I don't know why. It never occurred to me that I would be in harm's way or anything. And I think a lot of people in Detroit that live around Detroit don't go downtown. Don't, you know, it's dangerous, you know, the crime, the blacks, you know, racialists, the tension, all this stuff. And they build this false sort of misconception of what the city is really like. So they just stay out in the suburbs and they never go downtown. A lot of that's kind of changing. There are a lot of white millennials moving downtown now since the bankruptcy. But they're only moving down to a very small area of the city that's being redeveloped, and it's only 7 square miles, and it's right along the Woodward Avenue corridor from Midtown to the Wayne State campus to the Cultural Center to the downtown district. And it's all owned and operated by Dan Gilbert. You know, if you know Dan Gilbert, he owns Quicken Loans. Yeah, and their headquarters are in Detroit. And all 1,500 employees, he moved them all downtown. But Dan Gilbert is a billionaire, and he's made his money in, you know, the loan shark kind of business. And he's purchased about 60 office buildings in downtown Detroit. Huge ones. I mean, 30, 40, 50-story abandoned, empty office buildings that he picked up for like $2 or $3 million apiece. And now he's starting to renovate them all and stuff. But he's very focused about where he's putting his money. And that's where all the white millennials and young entrepreneurial type people are moving down to. But like I said, Detroit's a 138 square mile city, and they're only developing 7 square miles. So what's the rest of the city doing? Not getting anything, but maybe it's getting their streetlights replaced. So this is a portrait of Mike. And I just saw her walking down the street, you with the red wig, and I just kind of like hit my brakes really hard. And I just said, I got to photograph you. And she was actually visiting someone else whose house that I had just photographed. And she said, well, I don't have any makeup on, you'll have to come back tomorrow. And I said, I'll be here. I'll be here. She goes, well, it takes me over an hour to put my makeup on. And I said, well, that's okay. I can wait. You know, so I came back the next day, and she did show up, and then it did take her an hour to put her makeup on. And then I photographed her on the back porch of an abandoned house across the street. So I did a sort of elevated sort of look to where she's at. But then she wanted me to photograph an entire, you know, like fashion portfolio. And I'm just doing these crazy poses and stuff, you know, and changing wardrobe and everything. And I did it. And I said, all right, I'll photograph you. You know, I never used any of the pictures. I just used the ones that I wanted, you know. And even when I was photographing her here, she was just like getting so animated with her poses and, you know, and all this stuff. And I said, just stand there. Just be yourself for a minute so I can get a photograph. And this is what, I just calmed her down to the point where she just sort of relaxed. That was the picture I was looking for, you know, that I wanted. So. So, you know, you can be forceful in your work, you know, depending on what you're looking for. I mean, as a photographer, you know, it's one thing for them to allow you to give permission, right? Well, then what do you do after that? That's where the pressure kind of builds up. It says, oh my God, now I got to take a photograph. You know, so then you've got to think on your feet pretty quickly about where am I going to place the subject, how am I going to like respond to them, and you know what's going to develop in this quick relationship, this exchange between you and I. And you know, it's very much a collaborative sort of process when you photograph somebody. Portraits are really, I found, very hard to do, but when you get it right, It just sinks. You know? So this is a photograph of Melvin, and I just love that. You know what? Mm-hmm. He's got the word trust, you know, tattooed on his arm. And he was just playing hoops on the street, you know, playing basketball with his buddies. And I actually met his mother before I photographed him, because he didn't know who I was, but I was talking to his mother for quite a while. I just said, I'd like to photograph your son. And so he just goes, hey, get over here. This man wants to take your picture. Okay, Mom. So, you know, I mean, it was a pretty easy in for me, because I always had the mother's support. You know? Lynn Guyton sitting on the porch of his brother's house, whose name is Tyree. And Tyree was the originator of the Heidelberg Project in Detroit, which is kind of like an open-air arts project where he just collects a lot of detritus material and junk and decorates the yards around his house and stuff. So he's got about four blocks now that he's completely taken over and decorated all of the abandoned houses that are in the area with, you know, like stuffed animals and records and shoes and all kinds of stuff. But Tyree's pretty well known for what he's done in this on this project. And this is the house that Tyree grew up in, and just decorated with all these ducks and stuff. Oops, this is kind of falling out.
What's been the response from Detroit to your project? And I say Detroit, I mean, it's so many different things, I know, but has there been a response from the arts community, has there been a response from the city, from the different communities you're engaging with? Have you gotten any kind of feedback on that?
Not a lot of feedback, no. I mean, the person that wrote the introduction to the book was Nancy Watson Barr. She's a curator of photographs at the Detroit Institute of Arts. And they've purchased 40 or 50 of my photographs for their permanent
collection. But there's probably not a lot of infrastructure within the city for that.
There's no galleries.
Yeah.
No. I mean, it's kind of like, there was one, Kiyoki Abe started, he's a photographer, teaches at the College for Creative Studies. He started the contemporary, the Detroit, the DCCP, Detroit Center for Contemporary Photography. And he had a gallery set up at an industrial space that lasted about a year. He lost all his support and closed the gallery up. That's the only full-time photography, contemporary photography venue that was in Detroit. And, you know, it's not like Chicago where there's lots of galleries and stuff, interest going on, the Museum of Contemporary Photography. Detroit has MOCAD, which is the Museum of Contemporary Art in Detroit, but that's mixed media and all kinds of, you know, other art subjects, but no, I mean, there are photographers in Detroit that are doing work, but it's not a cohesive group.
Yeah.
Yeah. Unfortunately, there's still one more.
Do you communicate with all the other photographers, or do they reach out to you?
Oh, yeah, I mean, a lot of them, I mean, are friends of mine from, actually the ones that are still living there that I went to school with are actively still photographing.
Did they ever want to join you when you go out and photograph?
I did at first. I actually hung around with them quite a bit. In my first few weeks, I went back to Detroit. But they were taking me to the Packard plant and the Michigan train station and all these places that they thought I would like, which were abandoned, you know, industrial sites. And I did that for like a week, and I just got, you know, a bad feeling in my stomach. Why do I need to see this? Why do I need to document this? This has been done. And that's when I started realizing I've got to come back here and photograph people. I've got to do something different. So, and I still see them, friends, yeah. A couple of kids that were canvassing a neighborhood trying to sell these pit bull puppies, you know, going door to door, selling the puppy for like $100. Pit bulls are the most prevalent, popular dog in Detroit because of their reputation to be good guard dogs, and people are fearful. But I just love this kind of sucker. They're still pits. just have a few left, you guys. This is a portrait of Tammy. Tammy was a prostitute and a coke addict, or, you know, cocaine and crack addict. And I photographed a lot of prostitutes for about a year and a half. And I just did full frame portraits of all of them, but got to the point where I was getting really depressed photographing them because their lives were in such shambles.
She looks familiar, you know. It's just, I think it's the certain elements that are repeat, you know, throughout this this lifestyle.
I see her all the time when I go back. I mean, she's still walking the streets, and you know, she's still sort of like trapped.
She looks like she's crying.
She was, yeah. Mm-hmm. Her eyes were all bloodshot. You want to hear the story about that? I was photographing her, and then all of the prostitutes that I photographed were white. And I wanted to say something about why are there so many white prostitutes in Detroit, in a city that's 83% black. Mm-hmm. And it's all because of the drugs, how easy they are to get, and how the police don't really raid the dope houses all that frequently. So that's what draws them into the city. The drugs, the heroin's cheap, and so I was photographing Tammy, and a black prostitute came up to me and said, "I'll let you take my picture if you give me some money." And I politely refused. I said, "I'm really just doing a documentary project on white prostitutes," and she couldn't get that at all. So then she started beating Tammy up, and they're brawling on the street, and I have to like intervene and break the fight up. So I grabbed the one woman and I pulled her off of Tammy, and I said, you have to leave. And Tammy's crying and weeping and, you know, uncontrollably. And so I pretty much just put my life on the line, because the woman could have had a gun and shot me.
Sure it happens.
And she was pretty much out of it anyway. I think she was high. But I did chase her away, and then afterwards I said, "All right, Tammy, now I want to take a picture again. Let's finish this up." And that's when I took this photograph. So she was kind of looking at me in a very much, I don't know, in a way that was kind of, I saved her.
Yeah.
Sense, you know.
Yeah.
And that sort of like came through in the expression that she gave me. And these are a couple of kids that were good friends, and they were going to the park to hang out and look for snakes and stuff. That's what they told me. We're gonna go find some snakes. But I love just the relationship between the two. That's David and that's Drew.
That's
at her house.
Yeah.
She lives in a house with her two other sisters and mother, and about three kids, three little babies. And I photographed all three sisters, never all at the same time, but at three different times, you know. So I went back and gave them all, you know, prints of the portrait I did. But this one, just, you know, expression on her face is just very calm.
Regal.
Yeah. And this is one of the images from the series of prostitutes that I documented. And this is a portrait of Melanie. was a very severe heroin addict. I mean, she was 3 or 4 times a day heroin addict. She had to have $150 a day habit. It's funny because I've had some emails from people that knew some of the women that I photographed, you know, wanted to know about their whereabouts or what's happened to them, or could you please take that photograph down from your website because I know this woman now and she's gotten clean and we don't want to let anybody know. And I said, of course I will.
Yeah.
So I was very respectful of that and happy that they actually contacted me. I got one last week about a woman that I photographed, and she's been pregnant like twice, and now she's pregnant again. Her baby's due in December. And the woman that contacted me wanted to adopt her baby.
Right.
She was a friend with her. And she said, do you know where she's at? And I'm trying to find her. And I said, well, the last time I photographed her was over a year ago. You know, she was over on 4th Street by Livernois, and that's where she always kind of hung out. And there was a second floor apartment building where, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 of the prostitutes lived together. I said, you could try going over there and seeing if, anybody knows her whereabouts and stuff. So I was trying to help her out. So.
Well, the work is really a perfect storm of, and it's really deeply felt, commitment to the photographic medium. Is absolutely, it's hard to separate out the prints are so absolutely gorgeous. There's so many small things about the crafting that went into the, you know, the choice of the depth of field and the small subtleties with composition that's going on at Tammy with the trees sort of, arching on either side of the frame. It's just, I'm so glad that these students got to see this work.